everything that is here is what every physical form that you see. Physical form that you see does not mean only the physical form that you see on this earth. It also can mean what planets, it can mean the sun, the moon, the galaxies. Any physical form that you see is a combination of these three elements. Okay. Now, why? You can ask one question. Why is it that some of these forms are able to interact with the universe, what we call them living beings, and why some are what we call inert? Right? So that means this table does not say, oh, I'm so bored sitting here, let me go out for a walk by the Ganga. But you can say that, right? After 1 hour, oh, we need a break now, right? So that means I need to go out and do something else. So what is the difference between both are physical forms? Both are nothing but what? Made up of three elements, right? And in both these, there is what? Presence of Ishvara. And wherever there is presence of Ishvara, there is what? The Vastu, Nisat and Chit. So still, what is it which makes difference between the table and me, or a bird, or any other living being? Right? You need to ask that question. So this is what we say, there is an increasing level of complexity in the universe. And all this is made possible through what? Certain coming together of things. So what accounts for a physical form having ability to interact with the universe, right, is what we call prana. So that means this is a prana. Prana is the one which makes the body alive. So that means, what is this prana? Prana is what we call life force. What is this life force? The life force is, there is an external air which is there for everyone. But there is something in this organism which enables it to take in that air and what? Take it in and then what? Somehow use it to what? To make the body alive. So that means the prana does a few functions to keep you alive. First, inhaling. That means you need to take the air which is outside. You can't just stop doing it. And how many times in a day do you breathe in? You don't think about it, but you're constantly drawing from the external air to keep your physical body alive. Constantly. So what is an unconscious process, what does pranayama do? It makes it more conscious. You become aware of the fact that you are constantly drawing from the air that is there and that is nourishing the body. Now, after it enters the body, there is one aspect of prana which serves many, many different functions. Right? What it does is, what does it mean when I say the body is alive? What it does is, it keeps what? The senses working. When you breathe in the air, it's not just keeping the body alive in the sense that it is just alive. The senses gain their capacity. Something subtle happens. So what does it mean? The physical eyes are blessed with the sight. Prana. The physical ears are blessed with capacity to hear. The physical nose is blessed with capacity to smell. The tongue is given the capacity to taste. And the touch. So that is one function of the prana. Now, while the prana makes your senses alive, it goes in there, right? And what else does it do? It keeps all your organs going. So that means your organs do different functions to keep the body alive. So what do? The food that you have eaten, and those organs, what do? They digest the food that is eaten. Without prana, it's not possible. So that means it keeps the organs functioning. Now, the digested food is converted into what?
Energy
and blood circulation. So that means the prana also enables the digested food to be equally distributed throughout the body to nourish the body. Every cell is nourished through circulatory system. So that means you absorb all the nourishment, and then what you do is you provide that nourishment. There is a system within the body which equally distributes that nourishment to different parts of the body. Now, in that process of absorption and conversion of the external food through the digestive system and nourishment, there is something which is remaining unused.
Excretion.
So there is a system within your body. This is all function of prana. After having absorbed the nutrient, the remains have to be thrown out. You can't keep retaining everything. So that means there is a throwing out, which is what we call excretion. So that means that excretion, in that excretion function, there is also detox. That means all the waste, all the things which are undigested, the body gets rid of it. All a function of prana. This is why when you do pranayama, you think, what am I doing? I'm just breathing in and out. What's the big deal? When you do it consciously, what you do is what make all this system. In addition to that, what you also do when you breathe in consciously and really deeply, there is the prana not only keeps the body alive, it also keeps what? The mind functioning. So what they say is that when you do pranayama, I have a cousin who is at Stanford University, and she's a yoga therapist as well as a physiotherapist, and she does a lot of research. And what they do is, the person who does pranayama, they study the brain, and they say that the whole neuron channels of the brain also are far sharper if you do pranayama. That means you provide enough oxygen to the brain, and the brain functions well also. There are neurological changes. So that means, so this prana is not an ordinary thing. So in that, while there is prana, there is what your body is, what we call a living being. So that means, what is there in addition to all the physical forms? See, we see that it gets increasing what? Increasing complexity. So that means, and that increasing complexity is added through what? Prana. And what is the word, where is this prana coming from? Same, where? In fact, what it says is, it will show in the end, this prana itself is what? The whole subtle body, of which prana is one function, itself is from three elements. And those three elements are from Ishvara. And Ishvara's true nature is Sat and Chit. So how, at every level of addition, what do you remind yourself? You become aware of that addition, and you also remind yourself of what? The presence of Ishvara, in whose presence this additional function is possible. And while it is possible, that's why Ishvara is nothing but possibilities which are collapsed, potentials which are collapsed. And while all that happens, what remains unchanging is Atma, Sat and Chit, which is the very truth of Ishvara. So that means now, in this prana, what happens is, how do I know that there is this prana, which is, because it's subtle. Subtle means, if you open your eyes, you will see the physical eye, but you can't see what? The sight. You can't see it. I can see the physical ear, but I can't see what? The hearing capacity. This is why, by just looking at your ears, I have no access to what, whether you hear, how well you hear. I can't tell. It's subtle. So therefore, this is what we call, it is subtle. So that means you need to demonstrate, right? Subtle means you can't see it with the eyes. The minute you can't see it with the eyes, for you, it can become what? Just a belief. You can say, why should I believe that there is prana? I don't see it. So, there is a method that the father uses to make the son realize that there is something which is there. You may not be able to see it, but he shows how the presence and absence of it can impair function. So he does his experiment and he tells his son that for 15 days what you do is panchadasha ani na ashakaha. Okay, so that means for 15 days what you do is you take only the water and you stop eating food. So now what happens is the Shweta Ketu, he stops eating food. So, for 15 days he eats no food. And he says, you don't eat food, but you keep drinking water. So that means, the water will not keep you alive, because it needs to keep you alive, right? So you keep drinking water, but stop eating. So now, what happens is, Shweta Ketu stops eating for 15 days. Now, after the 15th day, the father tells him, now, iti ucha somya yajumshi samani iti saha uvacha na vaima pratibhanti bhumiti. Then he says, now you chant, after 15 days of fasting, he says, you chant Yajurveda, because Shweta Ketu knew it all. He was the brightest student in his Gurukula. He didn't know this knowledge, but he had marked up many things. So he knew the Vedas. He did not know the meaning of what Vedanta is talking about, but he knew many things. So he says, now you chant all the Vedas that you are so proud of, learning and learning well. Samaveda, Yajurveda, which he knew it all by heart. So, after 15th day of fasting, Shweta Ketu says, I can't remember it. I can't recollect it. So then, the father says, so that means what you're so proud of is actually a function of what? Exactly. It's a function of food, exactly. So that means what it says is, okay, tamha uvacha, and not just the food, and digested food, and digested done through prana. So, tamha uvacha. Yatha somya mahato abhya Hitasya Omkaraha Khantya Matra Parishishtaha Syatena Tataha Api Na Bahuru Dete Devam Somya Esho Dashana Kalana Ka Kala Atishtaha. Okay, so that means this prana gives rise to 15 different, facilitates different, 15 different functions, 16 different functions of the body. While the prana enters and makes the body alive, it does what? It makes alive your five sense organs. It makes alive what? Your organs of action. Organs of actions are what? Hands, legs, then again procreation, excretion and speech. These are what we call organs of action. Then the five, all these, as I told you, inhaling, exhaling, then what? Digestion, then circulation and evacuation. And finally, what? So 5, 5, 5, 15, and what is 16? The mind. So that means this prana, when it enters, it is not just keeping you alive, it is making what? The 15 functions, which are subtle functions, what? Do their job. So now, what he said is, and in order for this prana, what? That there is one thing which I kept constant, and that was what? Water. So as long as there is water, prana can what? Keep on going, and it will keep you alive. But what did I stop? The food. And when the food got stopped, what happened to this 16 functions? Out of that, some of those got impaired. So that means you have something other than physical body, and that is what? The subtle body. Subtle body has all these different functions, and they also depend upon what? Three elements. If you stop water also, after 15 days he said you will not be. So what I did is kept water,
sustenance,
and I stopped food, and what happened is, within the entire subtle body, what happened is what? Some functions got impaired. Now, what this the father, so that means out of the 16 functions, some got all now. What he told him is, okay, now restart eating. So then, what he says is, that now you have experienced that all the shodha shakala, out of the 16 functions, some of them are all gone. So, here he says, just by stopping of the food, functions are impaired. So now, what you do is, you start eating again. So that means, what happened is, after those 15 days, what? Shweta Ketu started eating again. And after 15 days, he tells him, what? Now you chant what? The Samaveda and Yajurveda. And what happens? Shweta Ketu is able to chant. That means what? Things which were impaired, he regained what? The capacity. So that means not only your subtle body is made up of the three elements, but it needs what? Constant inputs of the three elements in order to keep its functions alive. Do you see that? So that means the subtle body is made up of three elements. But after having come into being, it just as the physical body depends upon the external five elements for its sustenance, the subtle body equally needs what? Those external elements for its sustenance. This is why when people, you know, interfere with this process. See, this modern world is incredible. People have so many eating disorders. And what this Ayurveda doctor said is, it not only affects their physical body, it affects what? Their mind. People don't connect the two. You start, you do some crazy elimination of things just based on one obsession, which is what I want to remain slip. What it creates is some, like your thinking capacity, sometimes it can create anger in you, deprivation. Deprivation is the biggest thing. Psychologically, you don't feel well. So that means these are all connected things. That's why to live with certain vision is so important. You're trying to do one thing, you're causing so much damage, you don't even realize how much damage you're causing to yourself through your own choices. So therefore, what you eat not only has implications for your physical body, it also has implications for what? Your functioning of your subtle body. And deprivation of food can impair what? Your functions of the mind. So therefore, this is just through what? Experiment. Eating for what? Not eating for 15 days and then what? Eating for another 15 days, and all those functions come back exactly as they were. Now, this is the second reason why we also pay attention to what? Not only what we eat, but not only that you need to eat, but you need to have what we talk about. What sattvic food. Because the quality of your mind is also going to depend upon what? The kind of food that you consume. So that means it's all connected. So suppose you eat foods which are so difficult to digest, then what happens? The whole body is so, just working really hard to digest those. What happens to your thinking capacities? Little done. This is why we talked so much about sattvic food. It's amazing. The culture talked about all of these. They saw these connections. We need to study Chandogya Upanishad to see all these connections. It is there in the culture. Not only it will keep your subtle body functioning, but the kind of food that you consume will also decide what? The quality of your thought processes. So that means there is this thing of nourishing foods. Nourishing foods, which are not difficult to digest. This is what how you define sattvic food. And not only you see what is sattvic food is not only nourishing, but as you were saying, with proper combinations. The combinations are very important, because as I told you, that if you have only proteins but you have no carbohydrate, the absorption capacity is reduced. This sattvic food has a definition of, and then also that it is freshly grown and not what it is grown and then you keep it for some long time and you consume it later. You are so aware of so many different factors before you consume the food. What is good for you? What is nourishing for you? So, what this doctor in Ayurveda, he says, what is good for you is decided by what the quality of the food is. Then, where it is produced, when it is produced. Seasonal food is much better than non-seasonal foods. Then, local foods are much better than non-local foods. Because on this earth, what is needed is produced by the earth. There is intelligence there. So he says people are mad after things like quinoa. Quinoa is not produced here. It's produced in some Peru and people like, yeah, that has good protein values but it's good for that place. And it is a marketing strategy where everybody starts searching for this and we miss out on what is right now produced for us, which is the best for us. The earth has that intelligence.
Alan quinoa, rajgira we have, and we have ingredients.
Rajgira.
Same.
So that means we think we are all smart, but we have lost some wisdom.
That sattvic food means that the three elements are perfectly balanced in that food. That is what the sattvic.
No. See, what it means is that you are careful. See, something which is nourishing for you, something is not difficult to digest for you, right? That is what, and something which is also pleasing, relatively pleasing. You can't make eating a kind of a mechanical exercise. This is why they say that you have to eat and you have to put attention there. Your attention cannot be you're chatting with somebody, you're watching TV and then you're eating. You need to pay attention. So what makes it sattvic is, as I told you, the quality of the food, where it is produced, in what seasonal food, your absorbing capacity, combinations, these are all the different factors that you keep in mind before that food becomes sattvic for you. Suppose you have a very sattvic food, good food, right? But what he says is the consumer, the person who consumes, can be what? Kapha prakriti, pitta prakriti, or vata prakriti. Different constitutions. So you can't say this food is good. You can't make a categorical statement because that food which is good for this constitution may not be good for this constitution. So that means this sattvic food definitions themselves take into account so many different things. What is sattvic? And the same food is sattvic in season, in that mango is sattvic in what? Summer. But if you try to preserve it and genetically modify it and have it in winter, it ceases to be sattvic. It's all dynamic. So that means your food choices are also what is sattvic for you, it is a different criteria altogether. And the more you follow it, more not only it will nourish you physically, it will also nourish what? You mentally. In the system of Ayurveda, all this is there. So that means you have a culture which is built around this wisdom. All going so much in detail and detail and detail. So therefore, and that, so here he says, everything has come back, all your capacities have come back and you are able to, what, chant the Vedas again. What it then shows is that there is something in addition to the physical entity. That is what a subtle entity then. Now, these subtle bodies of different people are programmed differently. What does it mean? As a human being, all the subtle bodies are what programmed within a certain range. What it, because the eyesight has a range. So that means, suppose you have 20/20 vision, you still cannot see what that little bacteria or so many different creatures which are here, viruses and all, it's all here. Right now on your skin it is there, and you still can't see it. So that means, human being has one range, which is the eye range, ear range. But a dog will have what? Another range altogether. This is why they have what? Sniffing dogs. Why? Because where human capacity cannot reach, what a dog has a sense of smell. This is how in the, at the airport, why do they keep all these huge big dogs? They can sniff and they can detect what? Drugs. Which a human nose is not capable of. So that means there is this infinite variety in what? The subtle bodies. The eye of an eagle is able to what? From far away, catch what? See the prey and then it. So that means each species has what? Every living species has what? Subtle body. And every living species has what? The functions of the subtle body. But they operate within what? Different ranges. Yeah, what is
it? I was trying to compare between living entity and non-living entity.
Yes.
Both have Satchit.
Yes.
Both have Ishvara.
Yes.
So whenever we saw living entity as a prana and the subtle body, so the whole function which is not there in the non-living.
Yes.
Now when we say that the living body has a chaitanya or a consciousness, many this body is used. So that's equivalent to prana, because I should think that consciousness is not there in the non-living.
Yeah.
So there is a bit confusion in a prana and consciousness.
Yeah, exactly. That's true. So that means, what is the difference between a living and non-living being is the presence and absence of prana. That sat and chit is common in both.
So they also have atma.
Yeah, so one. Atma is only one.
Yeah.
See, you can't have, there is no second thing in the universe. Everybody, any entity that is there, it has what? Atma. What is that Atma? Sat and Chit.
But they don't have certain body for them to be self-evident.
Exactly. For them to be able to transact with the world. You only can transact with the world while the body is alive. Otherwise you can't. This is why when the prana leaves the body, your physical body remains exactly the same, but it loses its capacity to interact with the universe.
So prana does not have any other terminology. Prana is just prana.
Prana is prana. I mean, here we use prana as prana. Yeah. So now, what he says is, now, he says, there is some kind of a subtle body and three elements, and each, how each element influences a given function. That is what is being said. So here he says that annamaya hi somya manaha. What does it mean? From this experiment, your mental capacity is directly connected to what? The food that you eat. Because without intake of food, what? The body was not able to, the mind was not able to recollect something that you already knew. Here he says, apo mayaha pranaha. What? That the prana is kept alive through what? Water. Consumption of water. If you don't drink water, how many days will you survive? Your prana will survive for how many days? How many days? 3 days without water. So that means the prana requires water, but the mind to function requires what?
Food.
That's why you can't give up food. You need to eat good food. And then what? Vak, what? Tejo mai vak. What? The speech, which is the element which governs the speech?
Fire.
So this is why they say what? That, see, speech, why is speech and fire equated? Speech and fire are equated because suppose you speak what? Irresponsibly. What happens? You create what? Fire. Fire means what? Fights. Heat. Right? So this is how. Yes, something triggers and what? You become all, it triggers that thing and you start speaking irresponsibly and then it's a big fight. Now the same speech, right, can be converted into what? The fire can do two things. Either it can burn or it can what? Throw light. Enlighten. So the same, your speech can either what? Create arguments and fights and disharmony, or your speech can enlighten. There is a power. There is a power that is given to you. All these powers that are given to all the living beings, you also enjoy. How do you enjoy this physical body you are given? You are also gifted with what? Subtle body. And that subtle body that you are gifted with is made up of what? Three elements. And those three elements are what? Making it alive. And how you constantly need those three elements for it to function. Even the subtle body to function. You need food for the subtle body to function. You need water for the subtle body to function. And you need what? Fire for the subtle body to function. Now, the question is, this subtle body that is a gift that is given to you, right? Either you can waste it away or you can not use it. So now, next question is, how do I use this subtle body and its functions, which are great functions, through which I can act, I can see the world, I can process information, and my digestive system and my whole organism continues to work alertly. How can I use my subtle body wisely? Because what you need to do is, before this final reality begins to stay with you, you need to what? Make all this enriched. The invariable remains invariable. It doesn't change. But it requires what? This is your gift, and this needs to be what? Before that invariable is created. So, in the evening, healing class, when we see how does this physical body, now what did we see? The, in addition to physical body, there is what? Subtle body. What is the subtle body? What are the functions of the subtle body? 16 functions of the subtle body. Right? Now the subtle body itself is made up of what?
Three elements.
Not only it is made up of three elements, it constantly needs what? The inputs of those three elements for it to perform all these 16 functions. If you stop the intake, what happens? The body, the subtle body's functions are also impaired. So now the next question is, how do I use this subtle body, which is my time that is given through this subtle body, I interact with the universe. How do I, either I can waste away this possibility to interact with the universe by just doing insignificant things, or sometimes even what, creating further mess outside and also within me, or I can use it well. So that we will see.
Oh.